Thank you, HubSpot, for sponsoring this video.
I cannot see you being a lawyer. I cannot imagine.
Maybe like a legally blonde situation.
Yeah.
That's true.
Hi, I'm Sundas, and I work in data science.
Hi, I'm Marizza. I'm a data scientist.
Hi, I'm Linda. I work as a developer advocate.
And we are live from
New York City.
Hear the sound.
First question, how did you get into coding?
For me, it was super accidental. I just took a class in business school, and my first language was SQL, and I loved it. From there, I just kept building on it, and yeah, it's been 10 years.
I grew up in the Bay Area, so I was surrounded by technology in the Silicon Valley, and my dad is a software engineer, so
I didn't know that.
Was surrounded by this as a child, but I didn't get into coding until my first high school hackathon called HS Hack, and from start to finish, building a website just from code, and I was just so fascinated by it, and I stuck with it.
So I was a philosophy major in college, and I only first started coding when I had to build a website for a boss of mine for a book, and was making some simple code, custom code on there, and was like, wow, this is really fun. And then I started teaching myself for a year, and then I decided to quit my TV production job and went to a coding bootcamp. So that was that transition. I was a philosophy major, so I thought I would go to law school, and I'm happy I didn't, because I realized that the reason I wanted to be a lawyer was because I wanted to go to law school because I like school, but I don't think I personally would have been happy as a lawyer. And I get to learn forever doing this kind of job. And that's what I love about it. Forever learning.
I cannot see you being a lawyer. I cannot imagine.
Maybe like a legally blonde situation.
That's
true. Should we get juicy now and talk about generative AI?
All the talk.
My favorite topic. My favorite.
Take us there, Sundas.
Okay, I will. So ChatGPT, that's like generative AI. ChatGPT has basically taken over the tech industry. The internet has gone wild. All the content creators are after it, including myself. So, literally, I love ChatGPT. But there is this a big fear that people now have because how smart these large language models have become, that eventually gonna keep making progress and our jobs are gonna be automated, especially people who are just new in the industry or still in school. Like, they don't understand the industry and the work fully. There's this a lot of fear within those people that it is going to take over jobs. So I would love to hear your perspective in terms of, do you think it's going to automate jobs? I actually recently, just today, I read somebody on LinkedIn sent me an article on Forbes where they said like data analyst job is going to be automated by ChatGPT. And like, this person is just new in the industry. And I'm sure like there are many people like that who are kind of scared that things are going to be automated and they're not going to have jobs in the future. So
I'll preface by saying I don't know the future. But what I do feel and see is that I look at it very much as increasing productivity and removing tedious tasks. So I like to call it my assistant. And I do think also that we're thinking about what has been trained off of. It has been trained off of human code. And so we still need that. And actually, you can't just trust it blindly in the sense of like the type of work we're going to be doing is a lot more like verifying, ethical, like all these other aspects that we didn't have to think about when we were doing it. So it does bring also all these new jobs that didn't exist. So as much as we might automate certain things, it will increase, I think, other types of jobs. The other thing is that these things take time. You know, when you look at the driverless car technology, like you're like, oh, like, you know, why are we, do we still have, like, you would think, oh, when that came out, everybody would probably be like, oh, we're going to have no drivers. We still have drivers. And the reason is this stuff takes a very long time and there's a huge responsibility there. So personally, I can't tell the future. I don't, you know, I'm not scared about it. I think it will remove tedious things. It will increase other types of jobs. That's it.
I think a huge misconception in tech and working in tech is that you're just sitting behind a computer all day and coding, but there is such a huge human aspect, like communication aspect, especially in the data science field. That's what like sets us apart from like data analysts and we're data scientists. We influence a lot of business decisions, and something that ChatGPT can't do is the data storytelling. Yes, you can automate like Python scripts, and like I loved your video about debugging. Like, you can use it for like simple, tedious tasks like that. But like when it comes to the human aspect, it's just something it cannot do.
I think that there will be some jobs that will be automated. But any job that involves like critical thinking, that will be, you will need human for that. So I don't know what exactly those jobs are.
I wonder if also we will work less.
I would love to work less.
Like a 4-day work week?
Oh, maybe it will force people to upskill.
Yeah. I think the type of work will be more cognitive heavy.
Yeah.
But maybe less because that takes more energy.
So I like to think it, like you probably have seen like the automated ML solutions. You don't have to build your ML models from scratch. You can just use those automated ML solutions. Even for those, the coding part is pretty automated. It's a lot of it is like drag and drop.
Right.
But you still need to understand like
right.
what to drag and drop.
Right.
What your data looks like, what is the right features are, and you need to like understand, a human needs to understand to be able to like do all of that.
Also, it's just like, you could say coding, right? It got easier with all these frameworks compared to years before, but now there were so much more companies that were doing it. And the same thing goes with like AI and machine learning, like how many companies are now going to adopt services and functionality technologies, even if they're drag and drop, or like you're going to have like an increase of need of people who are in ML and AI who are going to do these jobs. And I don't think there, from what I see, I don't think there are enough people to fill those gaps yet. And we need people with depth of knowledge as well in that to really catch those deeper issues, I think so.
On the topic of generative AI, I wanted to share this free ebook that has over 100 prompts on how to use ChatGPT at work. The ebook is created by HubSpot, who is also sponsoring this portion of the video. The guide walks you through specific use cases and prompts that you can copy and paste into ChatGPT to get smart answers. For example, let's say as a data analyst, you are assigned a project to improve customer retention. An easy way to get started and get some ideas is to take this prompt, customize it, and put it into ChatGPT to get smart answers and ideas on how to improve customer retention. These prompts are simple yet effective and turn you into a ChatGPT power user and 10 times smarter. You can download the ebook for free by clicking on the link in the description below. Now let's go back to the video.
Actually, I'm actually really, really excited about ChatGPT and all the AI tools. Like Microsoft recently introduced the Copilot. It's going to be inside Excel. I'm so freaking excited about that. I can't even wait to try it. I think the way we do work, it's going to involve, like you were saying. And it's like the new skills that, like assistant, like how you said, like it's our assistant. Now I already know how to use Excel.
Yep.
Now I have another feature in Excel.
Yep.
Which is like, now I need to learn how to use that feature and make it my assistant. So like it's doing the tedious work for me.
Yep.
And I am working with Excel more smartly.
I'm going to go a layer deeper and say, right, that I think there's going to be the people in tech that know how to use AI tools, and the people who don't, they're going to stay behind. And the reason I say this is prompt engineering is an art in itself.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a job in itself.
Yeah.
And knowing how to prompt the right responses and research, it's just like we were always joking about, we say this as a joke, but it's true that a lot of people, like you code, you're also Google, you're professional Googlers. Yeah, like, it's going to be now just the equivalent, right? It's another layer of it that we're also going to be having to use AI tools.
Yeah.
A lot more. And it's going to be interesting to see how workplaces navigate it with data, because we're giving data to these AI systems. We have to also be mindful about how we do that, right? And that's going to be a whole world in itself. So let's say if you want to convert some data, let's say I have this data I really want to express. And I want it to like give it to me more in my way of speaking. Like, I feel like I'm trying to figure out if the way to do that is to give it scripts that I did write and then tell it to replicate, you know?
Yeah. So I think I've seen some people do it.
We should do a whole topic about prompt engineering.
Yeah.
I think there should be a whole video about prompt engineering, but I have to do more research about it.
So I have seen some people like give their own paragraph to train ChatGPT.
Yeah.
Before they start asking questions. Because then they basically give a data and say like, okay, talk like this paragraph is
right.
So,
or they ask it, what do you need for a prompt? Like it kind of like they ask what makes a good prompt, and then
yeah,
they work from there backwards.
Yeah.
But it's quite interesting depending on the topic you're trying to get to, or like if you're writing, if you're coding. I think it's like, you have to find your, there's so much experimentation and ways to do it. I've seen some good ones. I think prompt engineering is a whole world in itself that I'm very curious about. Mm-hmm. Don't know enough about yet, but I think it's like the thing I'm trying to get better at.
conversation is making me so excited to try it.
Now she's going to go and try the ChatGPT.
Are you going to try this tonight?
Oh,
700%.
Yes. Before somebody leaves a comment and say, like, this person did not talk.
But he said did not talk, that we did not give
back. Give the mic.
Here, hold the mic. But this has inspired me. I'm a viewer, just like,
I think the first day I tried ChatGPT, I was like, I couldn't sleep the whole night.
Why?
Because I just was addicted.
Oh,
I was like trying different things.
The first time I tried it, I was like,
and then it was like the first one. And then after trying it a few times, I was like, wow, this is actually good.
So the first time you used ChatGPT,
because I didn't know what
to use. It kind of grew on you.
Yeah, it kind of grew on me. And then it makes good content.
But nobody could replicate delivery and personality and relatability. I feel like it's like half of content creation is adding those subtle things that you just can't add in a script, right? Like, it's like adding other layers, personalization, experience, things that make things more relatable, more exciting, and more attainable in a digestible way. I use a lot of fluff words right now, but you get my point.
Can I tell you actually what I always also didn't like about a lot of like kind of professions in general? That in corporate, many times your image matters too. Like, as a lawyer, I feel like you can't walk in with like blue hair or like for some reason, you know? Yeah. But in this industry, technically, who cares, right? Like, nobody really cares. Like, it's like I felt like I could also be creatively free, and I'm a creative at heart and I'm an artist at heart, and I need to actually feel like the option is there for me to be my true self, and even in corporate. And so that's what I feel coding allows.
I will say it takes time to get there. When I was in school, like engineering school, I couldn't be my true self and like I guess like embrace my femininity until I saw these girls' content on social media and saw that there were people that looked like me in tech. So it really does take a lot of like representation to see yourself.
You know what's amazing? That I also feel like I could go more into my authentic self because of the community I had online of women in tech. Because even throughout like not knowing a lot of women in tech sometimes in my career, I always felt like I did because of my digital community. And it plays such an important role in also you living that truth.
Do you feel the same way?
I do. So for me, when I started, I was like the only woman in my team. And for me, social media was kind of an avenue where I basically found people who looked like me and who also worked in the same domain, like the tech domain. And for me, that was really, really important at that time because I had such a big imposter syndrome. First, I was the only woman in my team. And for me, like social media was a big one because it helped me overcome my imposter syndrome, because when I saw people who looked like me and they were successful in their career, I could see that if they can do it, then so can I. So like that gave me a lot of courage to keep doing and stay in the field. And 10 years, I'm still here. I don't think I would have been here if I didn't see all those successful stories who were before me.
So much of what we do in life and careers, mindset and like knowing it's possible. And it's one thing to say, oh, yeah, I could do it. But when you don't see a lot of people like you in the hard times, especially like when it's very easy to feel imposter syndrome in tech, because it's really a place where things change so quickly, that without that, it's kind of like the mental mode is more crucial, in my opinion, sometimes than just like anything else. I think it's like the base of the house. And without it, the house crumbles. I can't imagine how many people also, because of that, probably stopped their career. So I do think it's like life-changing. Like, community is everything.
Yeah, and I see so many young women and girls who are entering the field, like all of them have such a big imposter syndrome. And not just girls and women, I think like anybody who's new in the industry tends to have a lot of imposter syndrome, because you end up working with people who are like really, really smart, who have been working in the field for many years, and you just graduate. School doesn't teach you anything.
Nope.
You learn it on the job, and then you graduate school, and then you start working, and you realize, wow, I don't know anything. And all these people who have worked, they know a lot. And that's what leads to even a bigger imposter syndrome. But eventually, with time, like, you get better, you like build projects behind it, you build success stories, and then you're like over it, hopefully.
You also learn how to be comfortable with being uncomfortable. Like, I think now, let's say when I don't know something, like, I ask questions I used to not ask. I think asking questions is really important, and I don't feel like they're stupid questions. And I think now, like, I feel more comfortable asking them too than I was when I was a junior. Like, it's like that confidence in like feeling uncomfortable is okay, actually, you know, it's part of the process.
How about you, Marizza?
Yeah, it's so important to be like in an environment that you should be comfortable asking even stupid questions, and that allows you to like learn on the job.
You know, talking about stupid question, I feel like also the word stupid question or like a silly question, I think if we just, it's a mindset shift, if we change it to like, I have a simple question, or I like that, a basic question, like that, I think it's just the mindset shift, like that, like you're, when you say I'm asking a stupid question, you start feeling like you're stupid.
Right.
Like you're not, it's like, not, it's a fair question. Every question is a fair question.
I'm going to take a note of that. Yeah. Going to change my wording there.
Yeah. No, I never say I have a stupid question. I will say I have a simple question. And you
answer that. Wow, see, this is the beauty of community. I wouldn't have known that.
Okay, should we sign off?
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, bye. For watching.
Oh, I was going to do a proper outro, but okay.
Bye. Bye. Let's do a proper outro. We'll see you at the...
We don't know how to do a proper outro, so we're just doing...
Our byes are longer than our eyes.
Let us know in the comments what you think about ChatGPT and
generative
AI in general. Do you think it's going to automate tech jobs or jobs in general?
Let us know in comments.
It was so hard to connect with people. Yeah. Like just looking into somebody's eyes.
Yeah.
Just, yeah, like just reading the body language. I feel like that part is not there. She just reached 100,000 subscribers on YouTube. Round of applause. And she's just girl bossing way too close to the sun. How are you pumping out content?
Honestly, I have my periods where I have my periods.
Okay.
Yes. We do.
I have one. You have a... We are all in the period.
Honestly, describe the period.